accused of abuse by his two ex-wives. Tonight, one of them is speaking out to us. This has questions swirl about what Chief of Staff John Kelly knew and when, and how Porter could have worked so close to the president after the allegations held up his security clearance. NBC News White House correspondent Kristen Welker has the story.
Tonight, the White House calling the allegations of abuse against top aide Rob Porter serious, disturbing, and upsetting. And now the focus here, defending the embattled Chief of Staff, John Kelly.
The president has confidence in his Chief of Staff.
Despite a former White House official telling NBC News, Kelly was alerted months ago about some of the allegations of domestic abuse by Porter's two ex-wives. The White House insisting Kelly was alerted to the truth yesterday after this picture surfaced of Porter's first wife, Colby Holderness, with a black eye.
I think it's fair to say that we all could have done better over the last few hours or last few days.
And pressed on why Porter only had an interim security clearance, despite the fact that he worked at the president's side with access to some of the most sensitive materials to cross the president's desk.
The background investigation was not completed. There was no determination made about Rob Porter's security clearance. There was not a thumbs up or thumbs down.
Tonight, one of Porter's ex-wives is speaking out to NBC News. Out. Jennifer Willoughby says that Porter was physically and emotionally abusive toward her. Concerns she says she shared with the FBI last year when they were conducting that background check.
Out. I shared with them the details of my marriage, the same as have been in the interviews that I've also done.
And one of the questions was, could he potentially be blackmailed? How did you answer that question?
I believe that the people who had the power to blackmail him would be women who had been in personal relationships with him. So, in short, the answer could be maybe.
Porter has called the allegations false and part of an organized smear campaign.
I'm not surprised that that's his reaction. I think it's really unfortunate, and I hope that in light of everything that is coming out, he will be able to face some of the issues that he deals with.
The White House says the president learned about the matter Tuesday night. Meanwhile, Communications Director Hope Hicks, who was reportedly dating Porter, helped craft the initial statement to the defense. The White House says at times Hicks recused herself, but didn't disclose any details about how or when. Lester.
Kristen Welker at the White House, thank you. On Capitol Hill tonight, big tensions and big drama playing out with last-minute questions surrounding that bipartisan deal in the Senate to avoid a shutdown by midnight. NBC News Capitol Hill correspondent Casey Hunt has the latest for us.
Tonight, Congress racing to avoid a government shutdown, scrambling to pass a major two-year bipartisan deal. Republicans praising increased funding for the military, $165 billion over 2 years. Many Democrats won over with $131 billion more for domestic programs, including $6 billion to fight the opioid epidemic. And there's bipartisan support for the $90 billion in disaster relief for hurricane victims in the Virgin Islands, Puerto Rico, Texas, and Florida.
You get some things you like, you give the other side things they like. That's what bipartisan compromise is all about, and I think on the net this is a very good solution.
But late into the day, tension as the clock ticked toward midnight. Senator Rand Paul holding up a vote in the Senate, arguing the deal spends too much.
We're going to have a $1 trillion deficit this year, $1 trillion added to our debt.
And in the House, Democrats carefully counting votes.
One of our priorities up in the bill, I have an unease with it.
Her unease over immigration left out of the compromise. The vote tonight to avoid a shutdown in limbo much longer than we thought. It depends on House Democrats, but it also depends on Senator Rand Paul. Because of Senate rules, just one senator could hold up this vote until the shutdown deadline is passed. Lester.
Casey Hunt at the Capitol, thank you. Now to what brings us and the world's most elite athletes and hundreds of thousands of fans here at Pyeongchang. All eyes are on South Korea for the start of the Winter Olympics. But trying to steal the spotlight, North Korea, with a massive show of force today, and lots of buzz over someone very close to Kim Jong-un joining the Olympic delegation. We get more from NBC News Chief Foreign Correspondent Richard Engel in Seoul.
Kim Jong-un hailed today as he inspected his troops. It's part of the dual
strategy
he's using for the Olympics.
Nice.
A mix of diplomacy and threats of force. Today, force was center stage. North Korea moved up an annual military parade for its goose-stepping and dancing troops would be seen around the world just one day ahead of the opening ceremony. But getting even more attention has been Kim Jong-un's attempts at family diplomacy. He's sending his younger sister, Kim Yo-jong, to South Korea as Olympic envoy, where she'll be part of a delegation having lunch with South Korea's president. Like the reclusive leader, little is known about her. She's believed to be 30 years old, studied with a brother in Switzerland, and was recently promoted to help lead the ruling party's propaganda and agitation department. But Friday at the opening ceremony, described in South Korean media as Kim Jong-un's Ivanka will reportedly be seated near Vice President Pence. Despite this new charm offensive, experts warn North Korea's nuclear threat is unlikely to change.
After the Olympics are concluded, I fully anticipate that they'll resume testing.
And today, Kim's missiles, which experts say could reach the United States, front and center. These are supposed to be South Korea's Olympics, but the North, it seems, doesn't want to be left out of the line.
Although Vice President Pence and the North Korean delegation would be in close proximity in that stadium, both the White House and North Korea say, as of now, there are no plans for any meetings or direct talks. Lester?
Richard Engel in Seoul tonight, thank you. At a program note, I'll sit down for an exclusive interview with Vice President Pence here in Pyeongchang. We'll have it for you tomorrow evening here on NBC Nightly News. And as all that plays out with North Korea, here in South Korea, the excitement is building. Team USA is here, the largest and most diverse American team for the Winter Games ever. And even before tomorrow's opening ceremony, some events have already begun. NBC's Miguel Almaguer is here with a look now at the competition about to take center stage. Miguel?
Lester, Americans at home are going to see a lot of familiar faces. Lindsey Vonn just arrived here in Pyeongchang.
Oh, shit!
One of 103 returning
members
part of Team USA.
Tonight, the Olympic torch is taking its final lap. The opening ceremony just hours away. Four-time Olympian loser Erin Hamlin will carry the American flag, selected by her teammates.
It's a privilege to be able to get that recognition. It's pretty cool.
The Olympics, a unifying moment, coming with controversy. Vice President Mike Pence, who leads the U.S. delegation, tweeted his support for Adam Rippon, saying, "I want you to know we are for you," after the openly gay figure skater was critical of Pence for his views on gay rights. Tonight, figure skating heats up the ice, with U.S. champion Nathan Chen making his Olympic debut. But the chase for gold has already started.
Day one, yeah. Really excited.
Sibling curlers Matt and Becca Hamilton from Wisconsin rushing past the competition, knocking out a victory in a preliminary round against Russia. First ever mixed doubles match at the Olympics.
Oh.
Sean White says he's ready for redemption.
Sugar.